boys and girls, and welcome back to Children's Worship. This is Miss Tracy here with you again on her back porch. I am hoping and praying that we'll get to see each other soon. I miss you so much and would love to see you all in person, so I'm hoping that soon we'll be able to do that. Today, we're going to get started with Bible trivia again. Remember, we had that last week, and I want us to continue with that this week. Now, these questions are a little bit harder, so you're going to really have to think about it. So our first question is, how many books are in the Bible? How many books are in the Bible? 66. Yes, there are 66 books in the Bible. Now our second question is this, how many books are in the Old Testament? How many books are in the Old Testament? So there are 66 books in the Bible, and 39 of those books are found in the Old Testament. Now, if you're super smart, you can use what you know and some math to figure out question number three. Question number three is, how many books are in the New Testament? How many books are in the New Testament? Okay, so there are 66 books in the Bible. 39 of those books are in the Old Testament, and 27 are in the New Testament. All right, question four is true or false? The Bible was first written in the English language. The Bible was first written in the English language. That's false. It was first written in Hebrew, and later it was translated into English. And number five, this one should be a little bit easier for you. Who was the first man? Who was the first man? That's right, the first man was Adam. Okay, boys and girls, you did real good with that. We'll continue working on that and coming up with more challenging questions in the coming weeks and months if we continue to do this. Okay, it's time for worship. I want you up on your feet, standing up and participating and listening and praising God.
Oh, 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 oh Hey, boys and girls. Thought we would be worshiping together by now in person, but COVID still has taken over, and we are still recording. So we are out of Romans now. I know, I can't believe it. We've been in Romans for a while, but we are out now, and we are jumping into Samuel. And Samuel is an interesting individual, to say the least. And I'm just going to hit the highlights here of his birth and kind of what went on in his first, you know, few little years of life here. And we'll dive into Samuel more and more. I think we're going to cover 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel. So we will learn tons about him. So I'm just going to give you a quick overview today about him. And then next week I'll be talking even more about Samuel. So anyway, we're in 1 Samuel. We're in the whole first chapter, which is 1 through 20. So I'm going to read 3 through 11. But let me tell you this, that a man named Elkanah, he had two wives. And Hannah was one, and Peninnah was the other one, I guess is how you say it. But anyway, we're going to focus a little bit more on Hannah today because she was the actual mother of Samuel. So let's read 1 Samuel chapter 1, of course, and we're going to read 3 through 11. All right, year after year, Elkanah went up from his town of worship and sacrificed the Lord Almighty at Shiloh. Shiloh is where the tent of meeting is. If you were in my Sunday school class a few years ago, everybody, the tent of meeting is the tabernacle where they worship. Okay, and it was in Shiloh. All right, went up to Shiloh where Hophni and Phinehas, the two sons of Eli, Eli was the high priest, by the way, were priests of the Lord. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of his meat to his wife Peninnah and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he really loved her, and the Lord had closed her womb. And because the Lord had closed her womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her and make her mad. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and could not eat. Elkanah, her husband, would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why do you not eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons?" Once they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's temple. In bitterness of soul, wept much and prayed to the Lord. And she made a vow, saying, "O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." Okay, so that is verses 3 through 11. So basically we see here that Hannah was unable to conceive a child. God had closed her womb, she could not have a baby, okay? And in Old Testament times, a childless woman was considered a big time failure because it was an embarrassment to her husband. Children were a really important part of society back then, because most families back then farmed. And the more children you had, the more farming you could do and the more labor you could, you know, you could get done with your children. So anyway, and there are some other stories too, but if you remember, if you're in this time and you can't have a baby, usually one of the servants has a baby with your husband. It's kind of crazy how things worked back then. It was a little different than what we are now, but that's the way it was back in ancient times in the early Bible. All right, so we have to also remember that this is a part of God's plan. He had a plan for Samuel, he had a plan for Hannah. It was just basically, you know, postponing her childbirth for a while. And we also see that God was moving in her life and in Samuel's life as well. If you remember back from Jam Camp, don't know how many of y'all watched Jam Camp videos, but we talked about all those leaders that we talked about during that week of Jam Camp and how God had a purpose for their life. Same thing with Hannah. So if you're, you know, struggling with God's timing, so forth and so on, look back on this story and see Hannah continued to pray, you know, which we're going to talk about in a minute. And, you know, the Lord finally did answer a prayer, but we have to remember it's in His timing and not ours, okay? So Hannah couldn't have a baby, kept praying, and finally we see that, you know, she does have a baby. But what she does prior to that was kind of barter with God a little bit. As we see there in verse 11, she made a vow saying, "O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." Okay? So basically, she's making kind of a promise to God right there. And her rival wife or whatever had always made fun of her, poked fun of her because she couldn't have a baby. She just kept praying. And finally, as we see here in a minute, he did answer a prayer. But she did barter with God a little bit. And we have to remember that we're in no position to do this, really. You cannot barter with God. If he chooses to answer your prayer, then so be it. But when you pray, you need to ask yourself, will I follow any promises I make to God? Okay? She promises that no razor would ever be used on his head and that she would turn him over to the Lord. If you're praying for something and you make a promise to God, you need to make sure you follow through with that promise. You know? How many times have you said, "Lord, if you'll only do this for me, if you'll only answer my prayer, I will do this or I will do that." And if you don't do the this and the that, you know, you're asking for trouble. You can't do that. You have to follow through on your promises, because guess what? Like it or not, God will always follow through on his. You may not like what he follows through with the answer that you were not looking for, but he always follows through with his promise. So if you're going to barter like Hannah did, you better make sure you can follow through on that promise. All right. So we've learned a little bit about Hannah, what kind of happened with the childbirth. So let's learn a little bit about Samuel. And I'm not going to give you too much, because we're going to be talking about him extensively over the next few weeks. I'm just going to give you a brief few little tidbits here of Samuel. So first of all, he was a miracle child, okay? He is one of a few miracle births. Does anything else or anyone else come to mind as far as miracle births? Pay attention here, this may be some Take Five stuff. What about Isaac? Miracle birth? Absolutely. His mom was really old. You can go back and read that story later. I'm thinking of one in particular, though, that is really a miracle birth, and it's one of the best of all, actually the best of all, is Jesus's birth. That's no doubt a miracle birth with Mary and Joseph. So he is a miracle child, Samuel was. All right, number two, his name means name of God or God has heard, okay? So when you have God in your name, he's got a pretty special part of your, pretty special plan for your life laid out. All right, number three, he was from the tribe of Levi. number four, he is the very last judge, okay? Can you name any other judges? And again, I'll refer back to Jam Camp, because we talked about five leaders during Jam Camp. There were a few that were judges, so maybe that will help you out a little bit. Also remember that for Take Five, all right? naming a judge. Also, there was one female judge. If you can name her, it might get a little extra credit, okay? So, he was the last judge because after Samuel, Israel was led by kings, okay? Samuel, number five, anoints the first two kings, which was Saul and David, all right? So, with that being said, that is just a little bit of a brief introduction into Samuel. This is going to be really a good study, and we're really going to learn a lot about Samuel, and I am looking forward to it. We will cover his dedication next week. I didn't want to give too much away. I could have really talked a whole lot longer about this, but I just wanted to give you a brief little overview of Samuel and kind of how he was born and came into the world, and we're going to talk more about that in the weeks to come. All right, so let's jump into the Take Five. Question number one, what is Samuel's mother's name? If you said Hannah, you are correct. All right. Number two, what does his name mean? Heard of God or God heard? Yes, that is correct as well. Number three, can you name another judge? Remember, I told y'all to pay attention. If you need a hint, you can go to Judges. The book of Judges recounts all the, or a large majority of the judges, okay? Gideon was one. If you remember Jam Camp, we talked about Gideon. All right, number four, can you name one of the kings that Samuel anoints? He anointed two, Saul and David. That's both, so there's both for you. Number five, this is kind of for kindergartners, I guess, because you you can easily look this up. What book of the Bible is before Samuel? Ruth. Ruth is correct. All right, so I know that was kind of quick, a brief little overview of Samuel. So anyway, I can't wait to jump into more with Samuel in the upcoming weeks. Me and Mr. John, excited to move on to Samuel now. So anyway, just keep hanging in there, kids. We miss seeing your faces. Hopefully we can be back together, you know, in the next few weeks. I don't know, just see how it goes. But anyway, just keep hanging on and keep studying the Bible, keep listening to the lessons and keep learning. We can still learn even though we're not at church. All right, let's pray together. Father, we just thank you for this time together. Thank you for Samuel. Thank you for what he means, what he has done. Thank you for his mom, Lord, who endured tons and tons of ridicule and bullying and poking fun by her other friend, wife there. Thank you for what she means and how this story starts, Lord. Be with us this week, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Okay, boys and girls, it's time for a brain break. Now, this is the same brain break we had last week, and if you notice, we know this song. If you've ever been to Jam Camp, this is one of our Jam Camp songs. So get up, move around, and then get ready for your teaching afterwards.
I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big. I asked Herman what happened, and he said, I swallowed one grape. I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big. I asked Herman what happened, and he said, I swallowed two apples. I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big. I asked Herman what happened, and he said, I swallowed three grapefruits. I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big.
How big?
I asked Herman what happened, and he said, I swallowed four cantaloupes. I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big.
How big?
I asked Herman what happened, and he said,
I swallowed 5 watermelons.
I was sitting on a fence post, slapping on my left knee, chewing on my bubble gum, chomp, 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 playing with my yo-yo, doo-wop, 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 and watching the birds fly by. And then along came Herman the worm, and he was this big. I asked Herman what happened, and he said, I burped!
Good morning, boys and girls. I am so happy to be here with you today, even though we're still virtual. But I'm anticipating with all of you, I know, August 2nd, when we get to be back together in person in this children's worship room. And I can't wait for that. So today, I have been rushing to get here this morning because I hope, just like me, that you and your family have been out doing a community prayer walk where you go around your neighborhood and pray for the salvation of those who may not know Christ in your community. So my boys and I, my sister Ginger, we actually did the 2020 version of a prayer walk, and we did a prayer golf cart ride, and it was so much fun. And we would pray for a few houses, and then we would move forward and pray for a few more. And I have this prayer calendar that has 30 days of salvation verses, so we were able just to have God's word right there, because there's nothing better to pray than God's word. And we just prayed verses of scripture that I had on this calendar for each house as we went. And it was an absolutely wonderful time doing what Christ would have been doing, seeking to save the lost. And we can't save them, but we can pray for them. And it was just a wonderful time together. And I hope maybe today is the day you and your family are out doing that too, on this day that I'm recording anyway. So getting back to what Miss Christie has been working on, if you will recall, now when I asked this in big church, I was surprised at how many people didn't know what word I'm teaching right now, because y'all are usually so great about this. But the word is changed. We're teaching about changed right now. We're teaching about the big church word is sanctification, that process where Christ and the Holy Spirit changes us into the image of Christ. It is slow, it's a process, it happens over time, and it's just part of our salvation journey that we're on till we reach heaven. And once we get there, we'll go through that final glorification process where we're made fully into His image. So we're learning about the process of change and also what changed people look like. So we've got our little cheer that we've been doing, and we're going to review that right now. And you're going to notice that some of my words are already written up here today. My teaching might go a little quicker because I'm not going to have to write, because I'm actually re-recording this series because we had some technical difficulties. So my words are actually already here, but you have not heard this teaching before. So changed. Give me a C, and everybody at home says, choose Christ. Give me an H, everybody says, humble yourself. Give me an A, admit your sin. Give me an N, number your days. And teaching for today is going to be, give me a G, and we're all going to say, grant forgiveness. That means give forgiveness. Grant forgiveness. And we're going to be studying about the unforgiving debtor. Now, this passage of scripture might not be as familiar as Paul and Joseph and David, but I think some of you will have heard it before, and it's just full of wonderful truths we can learn about forgiveness and unforgiveness. So we are going to focus on the unforgiving debtor today. And if you've got your Bibles at home right now, which I hope you do, your parents can help you look up Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 through 35. That's the verses that I'm going to be reading from this morning about the unforgiving debtor. So let's read that passage together if you will. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he wasn't able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and children and all that he had would be sold to repay his debt. The servant fell on his knees before him and begged, "Be patient with me, and I will pay back everything." The servant's master had pity on him. He canceled the debt and he let him go. And we're going to talk about this more later, but I'm telling you, that verse right there describes the way Jesus Christ forgives us. He cancels our debt and lets us go. He doesn't postpone the debt. He doesn't say you can pay it off later in time. He cancels it. It's forgiven. And we are let go and set free from the things we've done wrong. And carry on in verse 28, I believe. But when that servant went out, the one he just forgave for 10,000 talents, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him just 100 denarii. That is so much less than the 10,000 talents. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to the knees and he begged him, "Be patient with me and I will repay." But he refused, and instead he went off and had the man thrown into prison. We're going to talk about that, being thrown into prison, until he could pay his debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and they told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" And in anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he could pay the debt back. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of us unless we forgive our brother from our heart. So I'm worried he's calling us the wicked servant sometimes, because we walk around as forgiven people, and yet we are unwilling to forgive those who hurt us. And we're going to talk about that today. So thank you for reading that with me. And as you know, we're going to spell out the word forgive today, because that's the lesson we're trying to learn. Changed people grant forgiveness. And I want you to see that Jesus wants us to be a people who are ready to forgive at every moment. Ready to forgive. You're going to hear me say that again. First of all, I want you to look at the letter F. Forgiveness has no limits. When he said, "Do I forgive my brother seven times for what he's done to me?" And he said, "No, not seven times, 77. And I'm here to tell you that 77 is not a literal number. You don't need to keep count on how many times you've forgiven somebody. The picture here with his words is that forgiveness is to be unlimited. Over and over and over, we are to forgive. Now, I'm not talking about adults who might need to set boundaries in their life and not allow themselves to be in a situation where someone is physically hurting them over and over again. God would never expect that. But I am talking about things that can be forgiven. We should forgive, and then yes, if we need to set healthy boundaries in our life, we will do that. But all you need to know is that our forgiveness is supposed to be unlimited. We're not supposed to keep count, okay? We are supposed to be ready to forgive at all times, okay? There's a saying, this is not scripture, it's a saying, but it says, "To err is human, to forgive is divine." That means hurting people and making mistakes, that's human nature. That's what we're all going to do, because every single one of us is human. We are going to hurt people, and people are going to hurt us. But the key here is that forgiving them, though, is divine. And we know divine means like God. So if you want to be changed into Christ's image, you're going to ask him to nurture his nature of forgiveness in your heart. Be ready to forgive at a moment's notice. Don't hold on to things and get angry and stay angry. We need to be ready to forgive when our brother hurts us and sins against us. Because to err is human, but to forgive is divine. The more mature Christian, I think one of the ways we can measure our maturity in Christ is about forgiveness. Are we really ready to forgive? Do we forgive and let go of things? I think that's a measure of our maturity in Christ. So we need, forgiveness is divine, boys and girls, and we need to be like Christ and forgive others. O, in the letter forgive. Open your heart to share what you have been given. Open your heart to share what you've already been given. Let me tell you, your heart is full of the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. He said on the cross that day, when he died on the cross, that he forgave us for all of our sins, past, present, and future. That is our sins in entirety. They have all been forgiven. So if our cup is so full of Christ's forgiveness, how can we not open up our heart and share that forgiveness with other people? Have you ever seen when you're driving down the road that some roads are a one-way road and then most roads are two-way? Well, I'm here to tell you that forgiveness is a two-way street, okay? One way is pointing down the direction of all that Christ has forgiven us for. And then I'm telling you, we're supposed to turn and go the other way and forgive other people in the same way that we've been forgiven. Share what we've been forgiven. Forgiveness is not a one-way road. We don't just get forgiven by Christ and then we're not expected to forgive other people. No, we take what's been given to us and we share it with others. Forgiveness is a two-way street. Or, I want you to remember and take time to reflect on how Christ forgave you. How he forgave you. He forgave you unconditionally. There is no sin too big that it can't be forgiven. Well, there is one unpardonable sin, and that is if we choose not to, it's called blasphemy, and we choose to not acknowledge Christ as our Savior, blasphemy. That's the one sin that's unpardonable by God. But nothing else cannot be forgiven. Not murder, not adultery, not any of those top 10 rules, as bad as they may sound, they can be forgiven if we simply go and confess our sins and allow Christ's blood to cleanse us. They can be forgiven. He forgave us unconditionally. He forgives us over and over. His mercies are new every morning we wake up. We get to start fresh and clean. Do you let other people start fresh and clean every day, or are you holding grudges against people who've hurt you in the past? We need to forgive constantly. How does he forgive us? Well, he doesn't only forgive, but it says that he forgets. Now, God is perfect. He's not able to literally forget because he doesn't have a flaw. Like Miss Christie, my memory is horrible. Well, God's memory is perfect, but what is a better way to say this? Is he forgives and he chooses to remember no more our sin. It says he throws them into the depths of the ocean and he removes them as far as the east is from the west, just like the picture of the cross. And he chooses to remember them no more, and that's what we're supposed to do. See, sometimes we are guilty of rehearsing our hurts, is what I call them. We think over and over again about how people have hurt us. We dwell on it, and that makes the pain keep hurting and hurting and hurting. And then we hold on to anger and unforgiveness, and it becomes bitterness inside of us. And bitterness is like a poison, boys and girls, that literally can destroy us from the inside. It makes us so angry that we can't enjoy life. Okay, we cannot let that cycle begin. We don't need to rehearse our hurts. We need to choose to remember them no more, okay? And we do not need to keep a record of wrongs. We don't need to say to people, well, I remember what you did last time. No. If you've truly forgiven, and this could be a good checkpoint in your life, if you've truly forgiven, then you're not dwelling on it anymore. You're not keeping a record of wrongs and reminding people about what they did wrong. You are freely letting them go and releasing them from their full debt. You're not reminding them about what they did. You're letting them go. So I want you to remember how Christ forgave you, and that helps us forgive other people when they hurt us. G, grant forgiveness even when you don't feel like it. What I'm going to tell you here is that forgiveness, boys and girls, is not a feeling. We might never feel like forgiving the person who's done horrible things to us. But that's because forgiveness, though, is not a feeling. Forgiveness is a choice. So if we say, I'm going to wait till I feel like it, we probably never will forgive. And that is going to be a sin, because unforgiveness is a sin. Okay? We have to be ready to forgive because it's a choice. We just make a choice like we do any other act of obedience. I'm going to choose to forgive them for what they did wrong. And then I'm going to trust God for the feelings. We say, act the way we want to feel and trust God for the feelings. If we'll make a choice to forgive, and then as we begin to pray for that person and pray for the situation, he's going to change our heart. The minute you start praying for people, God changes your heart toward them. It's one of the divine supernatural things that prayer does. It doesn't always change our circumstances, but it changes us and our hearts. So we choose to forgive even though we don't feel like it. That's why I say be ready to forgive. You can't wait. until you feel like it. We've got to constantly, every moment, be ready to forgive because Christ forgave us. In fact, what did he say on the cross that day to the criminal that was hanging beside him when he said he acknowledged Jesus Christ as the Lord and said, please remember me today. He said that you're going to be with me. And then about the people that were hurting him that day on the cross over and over again, the way they hurt him physically, the way they hurt him emotionally, all he said that day was, it was one of the last things he said before he died, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So let us remember, I think when I hear that saying, it reminds me, they know not what they do, because to err is human, to forgive is divine. They know not what they do, especially people who don't know Jesus. We say they're just lost people acting like lost people because they don't know Christ the way we do. And so there, it might hurt us in ways that we can't believe, but it's because they don't really know any better. Jesus said they don't know what they do. He was ready to forgive the worst of sins. We must be ready to forgive too. Next, I want you to imagine yourself today in prison. If you're in prison, you're not able to accomplish a whole lot, okay? This passage said that he went and threw the wicked servant in prison until he could pay his debt. But I've always thought that was ironic, because when that servant is in prison, what in the world can he be doing to earn money to pay back his debt? Absolutely nothing. You can't earn that money back from prison when you're in prison. So I want you to see today that when we choose not to forgive other people, not only do we put them in prison, but we're actually putting ourselves in prison too. And the whole situation can't make any progress. Nothing can be resolved when we're in prison, okay? We don't have the ability to, they don't have the ability to change. If you put them in prison, they can't really change and grow. When you choose to forgive them, you're giving them the opportunity to change and grow with Christ's help. Okay? And when we choose not to forgive, this is what I'm going to tell you, we're putting ourselves in prison. We're not truly free when we're harboring unforgiveness and bitterness, okay? We can't live life to the fullest and enjoy the joy of Christ when we have those negative feelings in us. So what's sad is that we're often the only one thinking about what that person did wrong to us, and they've probably never thought about it again. And here we are in prison because all we do is keep rehearsing it, and we can't move on and truly enjoy life. So unforgiveness puts everybody in prison, and nobody has the ability to change. So please, imagine yourself in prison and see, this is something we don't want to do. Forgiveness sets people free. Forgiveness set us free. And now we need to set others free. We don't need to put ourselves in prison. And V, I want you to verify if there's anyone you're still angry with. The only thing I know to say is this, a little checkpoint you can say. When you think back to that person who just at that slumber party and they made such fun of you and they hurt your feelings and you said you would never forgive them and never go to their house again. And maybe now you say, well, I forgave them because I know it's the right thing to do. But every time you hear their name, if you feel hard feelings in your heart and you feel yourself getting angry, you've probably not really forgiven, okay? Angry feelings are a sign. They're like a check signal, like your check engine light. Something's wrong, okay? And it might mean you've not really forgiven the way you thought you had. And you still need to be praying over it. And you still need to make that choice to forgive. So verify today. Is there someone I say that I've forgiven, but every time I hear their name, I still get angry? You might need to work on forgiving them and really letting them go and setting them free. And setting yourself free too. And the last letter, E. I want you to encourage others to forgive. That's our job, okay? When we learn to forgive and live in that freedom, become people who are ready to forgive, we need to teach other people to become people who are ready to forgive, okay? I want you to do that today. I want you to think about that. So as we close, would you think about with me today, boys and girls, who is someone that I need to forgive? I hadn't let go yet. I haven't told them I'm sorry. And this is something I wanted to say. Whenever possible, it is best to literally speak to someone and say, I'm sorry for what I did, or will you forgive me? Or even you just have to go and admit to them, I've been angry because of what happened at the last slumber party, or whatever the case may be. And I just want you to know today that I'm forgiving you. Whenever possible, we need to live as people of peace like that and use our words to say, I forgive you. Because this is what I know. You might be teaching them a lesson in forgiveness. Maybe nobody's taught them that they're supposed to forgive people. So you're modeling before them appropriate behavior. But, adults especially for you, if in your past you have someone that hurts you over and over again and you need to forgive them but they're not still around, for instance, there were things I needed to forgive my dad for, but my dad has already passed away. He's not alive anymore. I'm able to walk through that forgiveness process just through a prayer time with Jesus, where I forgive my dad for the things he did wrong, and I release him, and I let go, and I don't keep holding on to those bitter, angry feelings. So I want you to know it's never too late to forgive, even if the person is not available anymore to say it to. You can be set free. It's just one prayer away. And then I want you to spend time today at home thinking about, even just this past week, the things Christ has forgiven you for. Because the more we dwell on what we've been forgiven for, the more we're ready to forgive others. Because we're not perfect. And neither is anybody else. So let's pray today and ask God if He would change us and teach us to become people who forgive. Father, we love You so much. And we're thankful for Your Word that is relevant and timely, and it has the power to change us. Today, Lord, would You nurture Your nature of forgiveness in Miss Christie and in the heart of each boy and girl who's watching this video? Would we become people like Christ who are ready to forgive? Lord, I ask that You would just do a work in us and don't leave us like we are. Please, Lord Jesus, that's been our prayer over this whole study. Don't leave us like we are. Change us. Change us by Your Holy Spirit that lives within us. This week, show us people that we can be ready to grant forgiveness to. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.